What really happens when light hits the human skull? I went to the photonics lab to find out. We tested three brain photobiomodulation devices, including the Vie-Lab Neuro Pro 2, and the results may enlighten you. Hi, my name is John, and I'm a physics lecturer. I've worked with Vie-Lab for over a year, and today we're going to talk about transcranial photobiomodulation, or PBM. The effort to stimulate the brain with light energy presents a unique and formidable engineering challenge. To reach the brain, near-infrared light energy must first penetrate multiple biological layers. This includes the scalp, the skull, and finally, cerebrospinal fluid. Each of these layers absorbs and scatters light, causing significant optical attenuation. In 2024, a published systematic review of over 2,000 brain PBM studies found that the average irradiance or light intensity was 250 milliwatts per centimeter squared, and the wavelength was 810 nanometers. We are going to test why these parameters yielded the most effective results in over 2,000 brain PBM studies. This experiment is also designed to give real-life practical application to the brain PBM irradiance reports by the PBM Foundation and two photonics labs, Optronic Lab, now part of Vie-Lab, and Megalab in 2024. Information can be found in the description of this video. These devices are similar to the ones used in the reports, a Vie-Lab Neuro Pro 2, a Suyzeko helmet, and a Neuronic irradiant helmet, private labeled from Suyzeko. Both of these helmets, manufactured by Suyzeko in China, claim to have a deep penetration with hundreds of 1070 nanometer LEDs. But is this actually true? Let's head over to the photonics lab. This is the photonics lab that we run our experiments in. Here we have a table set up with our testing equipment. We'll be explaining the equipment we use, along with the methodology to measure the penetration of near-infrared light energy through a real human skull and optical skin phantom. We'll also be generating a fluence map to show how energy is dispersed through the skull's calvaria. To obtain accurate measurements, we employ a suite of calibrated optical instruments. The spectral characteristics of each device are quantified using an OptoSky ATP2000P spectrometer. Its fiber optic input allows for precise spatial sampling of the emission spectrum. For power validation, we use a Gentech silicon photodiode power meter. This instrument provides an NSIT traceable measurement of optical power, which we use to calibrate the spectrometer's readings. A digital CCD camera captures two-dimensional beam profile through the skull and skin phantom, which is then processed to generate the calibrated irradiance maps. We generate irradiance maps to visualize the spatial distribution of the energy. These maps are essential for identifying the energy patterns through a human skull and skin. This is a real human adult male skull, ethically sourced from Ost International. This is a synthetic optical skin phantom, sourced from Kell Imaging, designed with the goal of simulating a real human scalp. Here is the Vie-Lab Neuro Pro 2, and the two light therapy helmets, the Neuronic Irradiant and the Suyzeko 1070 helmet. Our procedure involves three key stages for each device under test: the Neuronic Irradiant, Suyzeko 1070 helmet, and the Neuro Pro 2. First, we perform a baseline characterization with the spectrometer and power meter. The spectral irradiance is measured at multiple locations on the emission surface to determine the peak irradiance and peak wavelength. With the power meter, to convert the value with a 1 mm pinhole into a metric suitable for irradiance, watts per centimeter squared conversion, power is divided by the area, which is given by pi r squared. Second, we measure the attenuation caused by the cranial bone with the power meter. The calvaria is placed in the optical path, and the transmission measurements are repeated. The ratio of these measurements quantifies the percentage of light that successfully penetrates the barrier. Third, with the CCT camera, we show live footage with the skull. This map provides a powerful visual representation of how much light penetrates the skull and where that penetration is most effective. This is far more intuitive and impactful for a documentary than just presenting numerical data. We will only show measurements with a Neuronic irradiant, because the spectral profiles were theoretically almost identical with the Suyzeko 1070 helmet, given that they share the same LED technology. The data from these two procedures provides a clear comparison of device performance. The baseline measurement at the surface yielded a peak irradiance of approximately 11 milliwatts per square centimeter at a peak wavelength of 1,055 nanometers. Following the introduction of the calvaria, the transmitted irradiance was in the microwatts even before accounting for the blood and cerebrospinal fluid, almost falling below the detection threshold of our spectrometer at 0.075 milliwatts per centimeter squared. This is without accounting for blood and water, which the brain floats in. 1070 nanometers light is significantly absorbed by water, which is the primary chromophore for that wavelength range. For the NeuroPro 2, the baseline measurement revealed a substantially higher peak irradiance of approximately 300 to 400 milliwatts per centimeter squared. After passing through the calvaria with the skin phantom, the device delivered a transmitted irradiance of approximately 4 milliwatts per square centimeter. Now, let's take a look at the CCD camera. The CCD camera picks up a vibrant heat map with the NeuroPro 2. But with the Neuronic Neuradiant, we get a blank profile where the skull is. This means that the light emitted by the Neuradiant at 1070 nanometers is so weak after passing through the calvaria that the CCD sensor cannot detect any irradiance pattern. In other words, the photons have been absorbed or scattered to such a degree that measurable transmission falls below the camera's extremely sensitive detection threshold. Here are the CCD footages side by side again for comparison. These findings underscore the importance of rigorous empirical validation of brain PBM devices for consumers and researchers alike. The placebo effect is rife in this field, even in published studies. This is why Vielight actively engages in fMRI, diffusion tensor imaging, and other brain imaging studies with partner institutions. This sets the gold standard for brain PBM studies versus standard cognitive tests. This also underscores the importance of an optimal amount of irradiance besides an optimal wavelength. Hundreds of cheaper and weaker LEDs do not generate enough irradiance or power to penetrate the skull, compared with our patented VLED technology, which is designed to simulate lasers with the safety of LEDs. Effective therapeutic outcomes in transcranial photobiomodulation are contingent not on the theoretical output of a device, but on the verifiable dose that can overcome anatomical barriers and reach the target tissues. The physics of light penetration is a non-negotiable factor for clinical efficacy. These skull tests only highlight the transcranial aspect of brain photobiomodulation, but there's a more direct route to the brain. That's the nose, the intranasal channel. Vielight's patented intranasal technology enables delivery of light energy through the porous cribriform plate, direct to the underside of the brain. We hope this masterclass was useful for a physics-based approach to brain photobiomodulation. Learn more at vielight.com.